say that? What is the doctrine of wrestling? Because you know it.
In the presence.
Good. You heard it from the prophet said before you, right? That's the New King James Version says. But the original language says this: I will prepare a table for you in the midst of your enemies, in the presence of your enemies. Now hold on. Where is Israel? In the wilderness, right? Come to Israel. And Israel is troubled because Israel is in a dry land, right? And God says to us in His Word that I will prepare a table for you. Now I'm God. That's your enemy. And that's you on this side, right? Okay. God says, I'm preparing a table for you. What this? Right in the presence of your enemy. Okay. So if you look at this equation here, it seems as if the enemy is about to eat, doesn't it? They have the table set. But the question is, who is it set for? Who's God set the table for? So he says to your enemies, take a seat, take a seat. You'll be fine. Welcome, sit right here. And God has set the table up perfectly. And the enemy is saying, oh, this is a good life. This, because Canaan was a rich land. Canaan was a powerful land. But Israel is on the other side, going through all kinds of hell and turmoil and wilderness. Israel is saying, God, we are your people. We're supposed to be looking like that. How can we be in a dry land with nothing? Look at this equation right here. This doesn't look like a dinner to me. This looks as if He's supposed to be working, doesn't it? So God, I'm slaving all this time, I'm going through all this kind of stuff, and my enemy seems to be getting a benefit. Really? What did the 23rd Psalm say? He prepares the table for you. The church taught you this. The church taught you that you should be supposed to be seated with your enemy at the table. God never said that. He said, I'm fixing the table for you in the presence of your enemy, because you're absent, while the table is being prepared. But your preparation, watch this, the preparation of the table is based on your preparation in front of God. This is where the church misses the mark. Because in this area here, he has to be working. Let me see if you can cook now. He is preparing himself in the presence of God, and God is watching him. And God says, oh, so you could actually be working when you're struggling. You could still come to church when it's rough, right? You're not complaining. You're not complaining. You're putting up with a lot of stuff in the church. But it doesn't look as if I'm blessing you, right? You look like you have nothing. That's good. It's all confusing all over the place. And a pump can be turned like this. And everybody looking at you saying, you know what? I just know you're not blessed. Because then they look at your enemy. But God says, be careful, because the preparation of the table for you is based on your preparation before me. If you stay on your knees before God and you continue to be faithful in the work of God, God says, I have something prepared for you that you just don't see yet. But keep working on this side, because the more you do on this side, the more I'm preparing this side. Yes. Is the church getting it? Yes. All right then. So watch this. There are two times that you have to understand, the Greek words that I'm going to use, is the word chronos and the word kairos. The chronicles speak of time, right? Right. Chronicles speaks of earthly time, or chronos is earthly time. That's why you have a chronograph on your watch. It's a timekeeper that goes 24 hours, right? Chronos is the time on earth. Kairos is the time in heaven. God says, you have confusion in the chronos. In the earthly time, it looks confusing to you. But he says, in the kairos, I am making preparations, I'm making arrangements, and this side looks orderly because kairos. to a land that flows with milk and what?
Honey.
Honey. Now hold on here. Where do you get milk from? Good. You know it good. You're not from this area, but you know where it comes from. Half of you must be from the Caribbean. A milk comes from a cow. A little white boy once asked me, where does milk come from? I couldn't answer. Because the answer I wanted to give to him would have been a sin. Because he felt it came from a bottle. The plastic gallon thing. Because he never knew where milk came from. But milk comes from the cow, right? Good. Where does honey come from? Now I know that I don't want to think you're dumb either. I just want to say it because you get it right now. Milk comes from what? Honey comes from what? Gosh, I'm taking you not to the grocery store. They had no Costco and stuff back then. So the milk and the honey have to come from the natural source. So God says, I'm taking you to a land that flows with milk and honey. Now, if you go to this land of milk and honey, and you try to fight in the land, what will the cow do? If you start throwing spears and fighting people, you know the cow will run away. The milk will be gone. If you try to fight beside a beehive, you're in more trouble. So touch me and say, keep calm. And the source will keep flowing. Some of you get it tomorrow.
Yes.
Church, people lose too much because we fight too much.
Yes.
You have to learn to keep calm in the midst of the promise. God, I'm giving you milk, I'm giving you honey, but why are you fighting like a beehive? Because when you disturb the beehive, but you're fighting the enemy, you know what the bees will do. So instead of there enjoying the honey from the hive, you'll be picking the stings out of your face. You don't need to fight. God said, I have made you a promise, Israel. I am the one who's preparing the table for you. You don't have to go over this side to fight. You go over this side to dine. Do you get it? You are working over here in the presence of God and preparing yourself while God is working over here to deal with your adversary. It is not your responsibility to deal with the enemy. It's your responsibility to come to the table to die. Now stay there, son, because we have Exodus chapter 15, and I think we'll be good to go. Exodus chapter 15, verse number 22. They sang lustily. They sang. I read verse 22. You see, stop cooking now. You paid for the job. So he's still in preparation, isn't he? Now stop. Don't stop. Watch this. Verse 22. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur. And they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. Is that in your Bible?
Yes.
Were they just singing? And 3 days after they're singing, they don't have water. Look at verse 23. Now when they came to Marah, they could not drink the waters of Marah because of the word Marah means bitter. They couldn't drink the water because it was bitter. Therefore, the name of it was called Marah. Verse 24, and the people complained against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? Wow. How many days after did this happen?
3 years.
It wasn't 3 years. It was 3 days after something so significant as the Red Sea being closed up. 3 days after you have this long song. I never since I was so many verses in my life. 3 days, you can't find water. And you forgot that you said, the Lord shall reign forever and ever. Now it's, what are we going to drink? And that was the question that was polite. So Moses now cried out to God. So he cried out to the Lord. And the Lord showed him a tree. When he cast it into the waters, the waters were made sweet. There he made a statue and an ornament for them, and there he tested them. Look at Israel's response to a challenge after such a great miracle. But there's something else I want you to get, church, and that is this, that the Red Sea miracle was a miracle done with water. Am I right? Let me help you. The Red Sea miracle is a miracle done with water. The water's parted. The river they got through is water as well, isn't it? And the same substance that brought them great joy and singing is the same thing that has them complaining and is now bitter. Now let me brush your bubble right here now. The same marriage that you dressed in your white dress, walked down the aisle and been smiling all the time like them cats sleeping. That's the same marriage that had you crying out. It's not a different man, it's the same man. What once tasted so good in your mouth is now bitter, and you can't tell the difference. That, oh my God, is just a transition and a test. It is the same. Don't come tell me foolish, but I married a different man. Really? Really? The same thing that brought you joy could bring you the deepest degree of sorrow. The same son who was cuckoo baby, oh, coochie, 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 coochie. The same one is in the cell for murder and got you crying every day. It's the same person. The same girl you couldn't live without when the pastor told you to leave her, and you thought the pastor wasn't a man of God and he's just crazy and I just put a devil use him today. The same one. The same one. How do you know you're right now? The same young man you couldn't let go of and who you couldn't breathe without him. What's the song? If I never feel in my head again, if I never, that's the same one. What is it? Yeah, my God. Breathe again. Well, that same one right there, you'll never breathe again. Why are you breathing now? And you're telling him, give me some space. I want to breathe now. You couldn't breathe this after before. It's the same person. The waters were parted and they danced and celebrated. Now they reach another set of water and it bitter and it cried. Tell you, maybe it's the same thing.
Same thing.
If you're smart, you enjoy it while it lasts. And be careful how you handle things and hold on to things as though they'll never change. The same situation. Now I'm going to give you a preview as to what we're talking about in the next few weeks. Because Israel's whole trouble says a water problem.
It's a water problem.
It's going to help you right here. You never saw this in Exodus before. Israel had a water problem. The Red Sea is a water problem. The water being bitter is a water problem. They got to the rock. What was it? Moses, you can kill us! Moses said, you see God, now you see this? God said, take the same rod and stretch over the sea and hit the rock. Water came out. Then he got a little farther. Another rock. What a problem. The last water problem cost Moses his life because he listened to some stubborn people who showed him from the first water problem that the day you see this water is not what we like. We'll cry. We'll complain. We'll just go in the face of God and tell him he delivered us to kill us. Because God, if you want us to keep praising you, ensure that the water is always right. Now let's get to the praise break. Because the average believer in the church, they will cry and they will complain, and then God changes the situation. When the situation changes, they get up and they begin to praise God. And then some deep singer comes and tells you, let's take a praise break. And you get deep and you hold it back. Oh. You do all of that. But prophet, it's a praise break, right? Now, how many of you work? How many of you work? What do you do after the break when you work?
Go back to work.
You do what? So if you're encouraged to take a praise break, it means you just have a few minutes to bless God and go right back into trials again. Is that what you want your life to be? I don't want a praise break because a praise break is temporary. I need to be a praiser, which is to have a permanent praise in the midst of anything that happens. I would like to have a trial break and a permanent praise. I don't want a praise break because praise breaks are troublesome. Let me take you a little deeper into the praise break. The praise break is so dangerous that God says, oh. So the only time you could bless me and praise me is when I fix your problem. Now, God delights in the praises of his people, right? So he wants you to praise him, doesn't he, Dad? So if God is observing your behavior, he says, okay, you have a problem. When I solve it, you praise me. But it's a prayer. Then if you get that I solve the problem, say, stop praising me. So what do you have to do? Another problem. And then he solves it, and he praises it. But you forget that you solved the problem, so what does he have to do? Give you another problem. And when God wants a big praise, he has to give you a bigger problem. Because your whole perception and your whole conviction towards praising God is, it has to be a problem and a solution. I didn't sign up for a temporary praise. I signed up for a permanent praise. A permanent praise says, God, when I see the problem, I will praise you. When I'm in the problem, I will praise you. Because I expect to be out of the problem, and I keep praising you. That is the attitude of someone who has a permanent. Israel was not prepared for the permanent praise. So Israel said, whenever we have a problem, we'll holler. We'll cry, and God has to fix it. And the troublesome thing is, Israel is saying to Moses, we believe God, we believe you. That's why church people don't move me when they say this kind of stuff. I could promise you this, and some of you will be here and some of you won't. But if you're still around, you'll see what I say to you. When we transition into our own facility, and it's a dedication of the building, and it's so beautiful in your eyes, all the members will say, we will serve in here. We will contribute to this venture. We will bless the Lord in his house. We shall serve him with all of our hearts. And the dancers will lift their legs and they will flap their wings. And the pastor get hooked on the promise. But you see the first fire in the church after that?
Yes.
You saw it, Pastor, I'm kind of busy. My mortgage is due. The same ones who flap the wings to say, we should spend our money here. You don't build your life on the promises of people after you have come to something that's exciting. That one's not repeated because somebody missed it. Most wives, their hearts are broken for this one purpose. The day when the man put this ring on your hand, and the balloons were in the building, and the confetti went up in the air, and they threw rice in your hair, whatever it is. And they put a broom across, and you jump. If you're on the way, if you're overweight, you tip over the broom like that. Whatever you did in the broom game. However you made it over, you got over. I know some people have to tell me, listen, don't talk about lifting over any broom. You don't listen to me any day, baby. Can't lift over this one. So take it away. You go over the broom. You got over the broom. Fine. On that day, most men, because of the excitement in the air, would make great promises to you. And you believe every one of them because you don't understand the principle I just said to you. Whenever you just got out of something significant and exciting, don't listen to promises. Because they are emotional statements about the future. Judge your partner, judge your boyfriend, judge your husband, judge your wife based on how they treat you in the midst of the fire.
Amen.